Hey everybody, Jared of Second Life Design. Gonna do a chainsaw sharpening video. I get a lot of questions about how I sharpen my chain and how long they last, what degree angles are on them and all that stuff. So we're gonna get into that today. If you're a homeowner with a 16, 14 inch bar, 20 inch bar, chains are very cheap. You can go to a farm store, box store and get a chain for 10, 12 bucks. I don't know if it's going to be cost effective to sharpen all of your own. I hate to say that we live in a disposable world, but we do. I have really big chain, long loops that are, 170 drive lengths, 130 drive lengths. They cost $70 a piece. It's cost effective to sharpen them. I can get a lot of sharpenings out of them and they'll last for a long time. So that's why I sharpen my chain. I don't buy new. But if you're a homeowner, you have to kind of gauge your time versus your... what's your time worth and whether it's worth sharpening or not. The sharpener I'm using is from Granberg. They did send it to me. I'm an ambassador for them. I have a lot of their products. They were all provided to me free of cost. So just putting that out there. I do like this tool. It works well. I would purchase this if it were not sent to me. I would have it anyway to sharpen my chain. So we'll get a little bit into theory, and we'll just kind of let be a fluid thing. I've noticed there's a lot of videos out about chainsaw sharpening, and a lot of good information, a lot of bad information. So I want to just kind of maybe simplify things. Hopefully that helps people. Whatever method you're using, you're still doing the same thing. So that's the point of everything, point of this video. So just stick with it, and we'll see what we can find out. Okay, this is the sharpener from Granberg. There is the product number. Get a good shot of that. So what this really is, it's a DC motor. It's hooked up to, it's a 12 volt motor. I have my winch battery sitting on the ground to power it. What it's really consisting of, and what's nice about this thing is it's really adjustable for different angles, different types of chain. I have another video talking about types of chain, different angles, not, so look back in the old archives and find that. Really adjustable. For tilt, different directions. This piece clamps around the bar. You have some keepers to keep the chain straightened up, and there's a stop. This works really well. It's portable, so you can do sharpenings out in the field. That's what I like about this one. Having the big loops of chain like I do, if I nick one or two of them, I can fix them in the field instead of being done for a day. So that's what's nice about this one. The stones are different for different sizes, just like your files. So if you're doing it by hand, same thing, they're the same diameters. I think this is a 3/16, so same thing there. The wrenches are actually, they're kind of tied to the cord, like the power cord. So you always have the wrenches. You never have to worry about those falling off. So let me go ahead and get this, set up on here and we'll make some cuts. Okay, so we've got the fixture tied on the bar. So this could be on the ground, on your bench, wherever you need. It's all set to the angle, the angles I use for the milling chain. And so the only motion that's left is it will swing this way and it will slide in and out. So what you can slide in front of the tooth, then hit it a couple times and that'll sharpen it. I like to take a Sharpie and mark the first tooth, so I know where I started at. And these long bars, it's kind of hard to see exactly where, you get lost in the teeth, it kind of becomes a repetitious thing, and mark it makes it easier for yourself. So this little piece here is what locks against the raker, so it keeps it in place. So you're always indexing the same point. We'll go ahead and make it. You're fine-tuned here, and we'll make a cut. So that's really it. You don't want to take a lot of material off. It doesn't need to take a lot off. As long as you're getting a fine point on there, that's all you're after. It's cutting the whole face, and I'll get some close-ups of this after I'm done. But that's really the process. What's nice about this is it's all consistent. So you're gonna cut all these at the exact same angle, the exact same pitch, the exact same depth. That is the biggest mistake people make, I think, when they're doing their own sharpening, is they're not consistent. And when it's, you know, the old adage, when there's, you know, the weak link in the chain, this is the odd link in the chain. If there's an odd one, it's going to throw off everything, and that's what will give people fits. So we're going to go ahead and do this whole side, and we'll do a wrap up. Okay, one last thing that I'm not going to be doing on this chain, and just because it doesn't need it. So we've talked about in other videos, this is your cutting tooth, that's your cutting tooth. This is what's known as a raker. These have to be sharpened too. These have to be lowered. So as you're taking material off of this and it gets smaller and smaller and smaller, this has to go down and down and down. If it does not, if you think about the path this is taking, this is going right in front of the cutting tooth. If this isn't lower, it's not going to allow the cutting tooth to take a cut. That's going to be, you've sharpened your chain, it looks awesome, but it still doesn't, it's not cutting. It's because your raker is higher than the cutting tooth. So with this sharpener, you can also sharpen these. You have to adjust the jig, the fixture, to a straight parallel angle, straight to the blade. Straight to the bar, and you kind of go, you line it up with the high point of your tooth and slide it over and go down like 3/1000. The instructions are really clear on this. They're really nice, but that's what you're doing. You have to make sure the raker is below, just barely below the cutting tooth. If it's not, it's not going to be able to grab any wood, and it's going to seem like it's not very sharp, even though the tooth is very sharp. So I think that's a big mistake, especially with homeowners, people that aren't doing it a lot, where they mess up is they don't touch the rakers ever. They think it's just all in the cutting teeth, and they work together. For woodworkers, this would be comparable if your infeed table of your jointer was higher than the cutter head. It's not going to take any material off. Your piece isn't going to get touched. It needs to be lower, so when the cutting tooth comes across, it's taking the removing the material. That's, how you're sharpening that. If you're doing this with a file, they make file gauges, you know, raker gauges, they call them, and you can use a file. It has to be just a whisper under the cutting tooth. If it doesn't do that, you're not gonna be cutting any material. All right, so that's obviously a quick and dirty version of chainsaw sharpening, but I wanted to convey that it is a quick process. It doesn't have to be a long thing. This is a 56-inch bar. It was taking me 3 to 4 minutes to sharpen each side. I'll check the rakers every 2 to 3 sharpenings about. I try not to take off much material from the cutter teeth. In a perfect world, what's actually touching the wood to cut is very little. So your rakers have to be just barely under those, and that's what's gonna get you the best cut, the smoothest cut. It can be a really quick thing. Get a nice little sharpener. I've used hand files. They work in a pinch, but consistency is the key. Using something like this that has a jig with it, that's fastened to the bar, keeps everything uniform, keeps everything precise and exact, that's what's gonna give the smoothest cut. So, hope that helps. If you have any other questions, hit me up on Instagram at Second Life Design. Drop a comment down below if you have any other questions. Hit the like and subscribe buttons. Those really help me out a lot. The channel's really building and progressing. I wanna keep that going. If there's any other videos you wanna see, let me know, and thank you.